I should start with Amilcar Cabral, the Guinea revolutionary, who talks about what it is that we are fighting for. Securing the futures of future generations, nothing else. The question is, are we actually securing those? So how does the MPI help us to secure that? A better way of putting this is to look at South Africa's past and see how the MPI can help us understand what was the spatial dimensions of apartheid and how to undo it. So this is the outline of the presentation. The two faces of South Africa, the one that is poor, the one that is rich, and therefore we agree that the question of middle-income categorization is actually not an appropriate measure because we have middle and poor in the same country. So what does space do in terms of segregation, and what do we do in terms of measuring for the future? So what we have tried to do in dealing with the question of apartheid in South Africa, it restricted access, it generated deficits, particularly in the majority, and of course, increased exclusion. This is the apartheid city space, and you can see how the city space organized itself, white low income, middle income, and white better income. And then further down, there will be a buffer by colors and Indians, and further down, the blacks. This is how space was used as an instrument of change in South Africa. And therefore, multidimensional poverty, and this is a map of some area in South Africa, and if you look carefully here, there is a ridge here. And if you look closer to that ridge, you'll see it here that there is something that marks that ridge. It was a hill. And, oh yes, it's here. You can see that there is a hill there. And in that hill, there was a road and it ended there. And beyond that road, there is a black city. And the white city this side, and the two never connected. So this is the history of South Africa. And the level of segregation in South Africa, you can see its intensity across time. In 1911, then there was the Union, 1910. And then segregation actually increased. By the time South Africa became the 1961, the segregation intensity actually increased. And then by 1995, after independence, it flattened. The question is, how far has it gone since then? This is the index of integration in South Africa for major cities like Cape Town. You can see that 1991, 1996, 2001. Integration is happening, but at a fairly low pace, but it remains higher at the 1 kilometer level and much more integrated at a bigger distance. So at a micro level, there's still a lot of segregation. And the MPI, I think, plays a big role. And for Johannesburg, you can see similar presented, and the integration level is quite different. Now, this is the summary of the Cape Town and Johannesburg level of social integration, that is across races. And I just want to display this, that use of statistics and data is very fundamental to transformation and change, and we need to do that. And I just need to go through this quickly. I don't need to repeat this because I showed it yesterday. The government priorities, the medium term, the national development plan, the millennium development goals identify poverty, inequality, and unemployment as the key evils that affect South Africa. The South African multidimensional poverty index focuses on the three areas that have been recommended, and our experimentation with this has some results that I'll be talking to, and economic activity. Those are the four areas that we have looked at. Well, good infrastructure, spatial segregation, that's what we have. And Mandela, when he received the first census results in 1996, he said, at last, we have numbers that we can work with. So numbers do something to political will. How many people live in South Africa? These are the kinds of areas that we look at when we try and understand South African society. In understanding that South African society, these are the surveys that we run, particularly to come and compile the MPI, combining census, survey data, and all that, generating a whole range of data. What do we know about South Africa? This is a summary of what we know, urban areas, traditional areas, and farm communities, life circumstances. That gives us an indication of where South Africa is by those categories, traditional, rural, and so on, access to different forms of power, electricity, and water, differentiated by urban, rural, and so on. In terms of mapping, this is how that looks. And if South Africa had a number of people, 100 people, this is how the upper bound poverty would have been dealt with from 57 to 46 per 100 at the 620 rand. And if we look at food poverty, this had dropped to about 20 from 27, if you look at poverty line. And if you look at income distribution, we have this very funny distribution pattern by race, and which is bimodal and not very normal. And if you look at race, black men, you can see that, colored men, Indian men, and white men. And you can see the distribution becoming very normal from one race to the next. That's how, and this is from the census information. If we look at black women, it's even sharper. The bimodal is even more pronounced, meaning that there are people who are trapped in poverty, and you have to deal with that in space and understand it in space. And that's where the MPI becomes very important, in that it gives us a good indication of that. The Gini coefficient, we can see it amongst blacks, much more sharper compared to what whites are. So even though the blacks earn very little, the disparity levels are very high. And with independence, the disparity has even got bigger. So this is how the poverty incidence are of households, by head of households, if it's male or female. You can see by male, it's, poverty incidence are much lower. So feminization of poverty very clearly displayed there. And if you look at it by race, you can see that whites have no poverty whatsoever. You can talk about it's a colored and a black phenomenon. Here is by education level, education actually counts. If you have no education, and that corresponds with, there's an autocorrelation between black and no education. And incidence of poverty by age, it's actually a youthful phenomena. And with increased unemployment amongst the youth, we are actually recreating and generating poverty amongst the youth. By house type of settlement, that's what it is. And then, of course, we move into Sampi and show how South Africa has played itself out over time. That's 2001 to 2011. That's where it was by province. Shows, and here you'll have to press on that play button. But before you do so, let me just go to back to what the Philippines was presenting. This is in 2001. And here is headcount on the horizontal axis and on the vertical, and its intensity and the size of bubbles show what was inherited and how this played itself out over time. If you could press that play button over there. On the play button. Right. Good. So you can see that the intensity and headcount actually reduces moving towards the vertex here. There is also some areas that where intensity is actually increasing, even with the reduction in headcount. So it means that there are those who are actually being left behind, even in the course of progress. And this is for 360 municipalities in South Africa. We just highlighted a few of those, and Msinga still remains behind. Very great. And of course, if we can map this and look at poverty levels, the legend, and for Johannesburg City, and we can do hotspot analysis to look at outliers, neighbors that do not look like neighbors, where you see the high-low, and what is the social interaction that is happening there. So social stratification is so difficult to, and social mobility is so difficult, even when there is neighborliness. So the question of diffusion, wealth diffusion or osmotic, whether that is osmotic or is diffusion, is very, very difficult to do. And of course, this is just mapping poverty using SMP. These are the kind of areas that are suffering. Where are the poorest municipalities? And in this way, you can actually see that poverty drivers are largely a matter of unemployment in South Africa. Education somewhat has been tackled. All the other assets, dwelling and everything, are not such huge drivers, but unemployment is, and very related to levels of education. Here, what you can see, you will have to play that. How poverty was tackled was extension of social grants in the country over a period of time, and you can see the number of beneficiaries moving from 2 million up to about 16 million. The question is it sustainable in the current fiscus when there is no employment? That's a major headache, I think, that we have in South Africa at the moment, of course, with the increase in access at social grants, poverty, and then, of course, the 2008 crisis, which we didn't cause, by the way, but we were beneficiaries of, have actually hit South Africa and many other countries. So globalization of these measurements, very, very important to understand cause and effect across space and time. Well, what were the key driving force? Income growth, expansion of social grants, and of course, expansion of credit. Those are the things that we think have driven poverty down, but when you expand through credit, then you know you pay very hard at times. And of course, there are a number of programs that government is driving, such as land reform, compulsory education, no-fee schools, small business development. All these things need monitoring, very, very tight monitoring. You can prescribe them, but they need a very tight monitoring. What about inequality? Look at the Gini. Over time, it has remained very stubborn, and I've shown you amongst blacks that it is even higher. And per capita share of national consumption for the poor, 4.2, that is the lowest, and the top having 61%, and the ones in the middle taking the difference. So the question is SAMP useful for South Africa? The answer is yes, it is, because it is a micro-level instrument for tracking progress. And that's what makes SAMP very useful. And because of the spatial dimensions that it unpacks. Thank you very much.